President Trump made news this morning with the claim that he could pardon himself. He made news several days ago when he pardoned our next guest, conservative author and filmmaker Dinesh D'Souza, who tweeted recently about it, writing, quote, Obama and his stooges tried to extinguish my American dream and destroy my faith in America. Thank you at Real Donald Trump for fully restoring both. D'Souza pleaded guilty in 2014 to campaign finance fraud in connection with an illegal contribution to the 2012 Senate campaign of a person named Wendy Long. He was found to be using straw donors to circumvent campaign finance laws. He was sentenced to 5 years probation, which included the first 8 months of that probation in a community confinement center. He had to submit to drug testing, community service. He was also required to participate in weekly therapeutic counseling by a licensed therapist. D'Souza was also fined $30,000. Dinesh D'Souza joins us now. Thanks so much for being with us. Appreciate it. I want to ask you about the tweet that you wrote. I'm just wondering, what proof do you have that the Obama administration tried to, in your words, extinguish your American dream? Because to be clear, you did plead guilty. You said that you knew what you were doing was against the law, correct?
Well, you have to look at the context of this, Anderson, because let's remember that just weeks before all this went down, I released a movie in the theater, 2,000 theaters, about Obama. And in this movie, it wasn't just a critique of his policies. I was in Kenya at his family homestead. I interviewed his brother in a slum in Nairobi. It was a very emotionally damaging movie to Obama. And the president was very upset by it. And I'm not just speculating. I know this because he was regularly denouncing me on his own website, barackobama.com. So when that happens, and then a few weeks later, the FBI comes banging on your door. Now, look, I admit that I broke the law. And I admit, and in fact, I demand that I receive the same penalty as everyone else who does what I did. But the key point here is that no American in this country's history has been prosecuted, let alone locked up, for doing what I did. Typically, these cases are prosecuted when there's corruption involved, some sort of quid pro quo, or somebody commits a repeat offense. They do it all the time. And so for these reasons, I became suspicious that part of the reason I was being targeted was because I did something very upsetting to a very narcissistic president.
Right. You've said that this was, in other interviews, you've said that this was selective prosecution. In court, you never actually argued that. In fact, your attorneys filed a motion to dismiss the case, but not arguing selective prosecution. They were arguing complex legal technicalities. You offered no evidence in a discovery motion of selective prosecution. In fact, at your own sentencing hearing, I read, you said, I have never even said I'm being selectively prosecuted. I feared I was being. So isn't it a little cute to argue selective prosecution on TV, but in court, when you actually had the opportunity to not actually make that argument?
Well, it would be if that was actually the full story, but the full story is actually this. My lawyer, Ben Braffman, went to the judge and asked him if we could have the FBI file that had been compiled on me, as well as the government's file. Because obviously, if there had been collusion, let's say between Eric Holder and my prosecutor, Preet Bharara, it would be in that file. Now, the judge, who's a Clinton appointee judge, said, absolutely not. I'm not turning over that file. So how is one going to find selective prosecution if the very documents containing the evidence,
well, the judge
if there
said,
is evidence,
the judge said the onus,
denied?
Right. The judge said the onus, I mean, I read the transcript, the judge said the onus was on you to actually show any evidence at all of any kind of selective prosecution, and you did not do that.
Well, let me offer some evidence now, because actually we have information
but in court,
now
but in court is
of
when
what's in that
it mattered.
File.
I mean, why, on TV it's one thing to do
but,
it.
But Anderson, my point is, how would I show evidence of selective prosecution when the evidence is contained in documents that are in the possession of the FBI that I have no access to?
But that didn't stop you from
so
going on TV and talking about it at the time. Because even during at the time, you were criticized by the judge for doing TV interviews before your sentencing hearing in which you were talking about selective prosecution.
Right. At that time, I said I suspected it, and now I actually know it because, see, a Congressional Oversight Committee now has my file, and they've looked inside it, and some of it is redacted. But right in there, for example, it says, it red flags me as a conservative and a prominent critic of the Obama administration. Now, Anderson, if this was a routine case, Preet Bharara was on CNN, my prosecutor, saying recently, oh, this was a garden variety case handled just like any other case. But why are my politics highlighted in my FBI file?
But wait.
The reason I suspect,
that's your evidence?
In fact, I say No, my evidence is that the FBI is signaling to the Justice Department, look, we got one for you. Here's a prominent critic of Obama. You need to know that this is your political enemy. You may want to go after this guy.
But wait, wouldn't any complete FBI file, I mean, you are a prominent conservative, wouldn't any complete FBI file describe who you are as being, you know, a conservative or a critic of the Obama administration or whatever?
Anderson, if somebody is compiling a file on somebody, and particularly a file of political sensitivity, and you want to be careful not to target people politically, why put this kind of information,
so which that's is the only very evidence likely you have to lead selective to some prosecution, sort of, that you were mentioned as a critic
no,
of the Obama
there's actually more. There's actually more. The FBI decides early on, at the very beginning, to allocate $100,000 to investigate my $20,000 case. Now, Anderson, look, recently, as you know in the news, Rosie O'Donnell has been in the public and is, in fact, admitted to 5 times exceeding the campaign finance laws. But no hint of a prosecution, no discussion of it. In fact, Rosie said, if I gave too much, just give me the money back.
Right,
that's how these cases have typically been treated.
But you're an incredibly smart guy. You know what Rosie O'Donnell did. She did not set up straw men to funnel money through to a candidate. She gave, you said, 5 times. I think it was a total of, like, $1,000 here or there over the limit, absolutely a violation, but far different than, I mean, what you did is you consciously, and correct me if I'm wrong, you consciously and intentionally, you went to some friends of yours, got them to donate $10,000 each to this candidate, and then you immediately paid them back, and when they raised questions about it, you were like, oh, don't worry about it. So, that seems a lot more, setting up a straw man is a lot more than what Rosie O'Donnell, like, overpaying, no?
Well, but I think what you're not saying, Anderson, is that Rosie O'Donnell used 4 different spellings of her name and 5 different addresses. Now, why would she do that if she didn't want computers to be unable to collate these names and see that the same person made all those contributions?
I don't know. That I'm unaware of. But it seems like if she's this criminal mastermind, she would have, like, I think in one of the cases, you know, the limit is, what, $2,700, and she gave $3,700 or something. It doesn't seem like... Let's be fair.
These cases, Anderson, in fairness, both these cases are similar. To be in a better America in the past, neither Rosie nor I would be prosecuted. I'm not saying that by itself Rosie should be prosecuted. She obviously had no corrupt intent, and neither did I. Look, I didn't even tell the candidate, Wendy Long, that I did this. So clearly I was not expecting any kind of a quid pro quo. I think in an earlier America, Jimmy Carter would not have gone after me for this, and George H.W. Bush would never go after Michael Moore and try to lock them up. What I'm suggesting is that under Hillary and under Obama, we have basically seen this sort of a new phenomenon, the use of the weapons of the state against political adversaries.
Right. I'm not saying that that's not possible. I'm just saying you haven't offered any evidence other than in your FBI file. You were mentioned as a critic of the Obama administration. You've said this crime that you were convinced of is never prosecuted. In the court case, there were like 20 examples used of election violations that were mentioned in court. In fact, the Obama Justice Department prosecuted a guy named Jeffrey Thompson, who was a Democrat donor connected to Hillary Clinton. And there was a headline on GOP.com at the height of the campaign in August 2016 that said, Clinton's illegal straw donor gets sentenced. Thompson got 3 months in prison for his crimes. You could have gotten 10 to 16 months in prison. You got no prison time at all. So if this was some sort of conspiracy against you by the Obama administration and by a judge who was appointed by Clinton, although I think the judge was also confirmed by Republicans, why didn't you get any jail time? Because it seems if this was, you were really an enemy of the state, they would have really gone after you. They gave you a plea deal.
Well, they did. The government did want me to go to prison, and the judge said no and gave me a different sentence instead. Look, the cases
right,
you're referring to...
You said the judge was part of this nefarious plot.
He was not part of the nefarious plot, but he was on the same ideological camp as the plotters. In other words, there's no denying that I'm in Democratic New York. This is a left-wing state, and it's a left-wing environment. So here I am as a conservative. So one would think extra precaution should be taken to make sure that no kind of political hit is going on.
Right, but isn't you getting a sweet plea deal where you just got probation and I think you had to do 1 day of community service each week, educating the less fortunate? I mean, isn't that
Anderson,
a sign that
one day
you've
of
got a deal?
Anderson, first of all, I was ordered to court ordered mandatory psychiatric treatment. Now, think about this. Am I Jeffrey Dahmer? Did I put bodies in the refrigerator? I was helping a longtime college friend, and yet the judge was acting as if I needed some sort of re-education. I'm sure if I started worshiping Obama and repenting of my crimes and appearing regularly on MSNBC, maybe I would have been pronounced cured.
But on that argument, the idea that you were being sentenced to, you know, therapy for re-education, if they thought your ideas were so dangerous, why would they have you doing community service of actually educating a classroom full of people? Isn't that what you were doing for your community service? They were putting you in front of people actually because of how intelligent you are.
Well, the judge was afraid that if I spoke to immigrants about America and about issues, I would actually have a positive effect on them and might even convert them to my way of thinking. So he basically said, I will not approve any community service program where you can share your ideas. I merely want you to be teaching the English language. And so my sentence was contrived in a way to prevent me from having that kind of influence.
All right. Dinesh D'Souza, I appreciate you being on. Thank you very much.